Welcome back to Uncharted, Drake's Fortune. Alright, so let's see.
For a minute there, I thought you were going to shoot Elena or something.
Actually, Dibs, Elena is not with us at the moment.
Oh, sorry, I got mixed up.
In fact, we're supposed to try to rescue Elena right now.
Yeah, and then Nathan Drake just shot Elena and Ed, completely ruining the continuity of the rest of the series.
Is he sure this is going to be a common...
Sorry.
Don't remind me of that stupid ending.
Of what?
Of what?
You're giving me Mass Effect 3 flashbacks.
Oh, that, yeah.
He doesn't necessarily shoot the female protagonist, but he might as well have. Well, then again, I'm just talking about the original ending.
One of the common things in Uncharted is that Elena keeps getting in trouble because, you know, she wants to get always the story, and of course the bad guys always get her. And then whenever Nate tries to rescue her, she ends up rescuing herself and surprising Nathan and even saving Nathan in the process. And that's what happens when you get hit by the traps. Alright, there we go. Fortunately, I just literally hit a checkpoint, so we're cool. Okay. Basically, what you have to do is when if you accidentally trigger a trap, it's okay. All you have to do is press circle as it prompts you right there. There you go.
So, just be careful.
Yeah.
What the heck? Never
mind. All right.
to choose now, but oh well.
Well, I love how far back that guy was taken by the shot.
Anyway, as I was saying, so yeah, Lois Lane, April O'Neil, and Elena. They must have the most deliberating of chats.
Yeah, it's one of Ryder's favorite female type of characters. The journalist who keeps getting in trouble because of her determination.
Which I'll admit, I may get shot at for this, but I don't really have much trouble with that stereotype as long as it's done well enough. With April O'Neil, she did have it coming, and she handles the situations well enough.
Depends on which interpretation of April O'Neil you're talking about, though. Like the one in the '80s cartoon. I mean, that cartoon is already played for laughs anyway, so it doesn't really matter much.
Yeah.
In
the '80s cartoon, she clearly had it coming every time, so you kind of couldn't really get the sense she was a damsel so much as she was, you know.
What else are you gonna say, Pedro?
The one in the 2003 cartoon. I'm actually not really that familiar with that cartoon, so I can't really speak for that, but the one in the 2007 CGI movie, she actually had apparently sword fighting skills. How the hell does that fit with her character exactly?
What about the 2012 version?
The 2012 version, she's just 20... a mess. She's
oh,
just
you
she,
mean the TV
she,
series?
No, actually, he's talking about the TV series. I haven't seen that series, so I
the 2012 know. TV show.
It's a pretty good TV show.
Oh yeah.
What TV show is this?
The 2012
Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles. It's kind of like pretty much the equivalent to Transformers Prime for Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, shall we say.
Alright, and here's...
Okay, I only watched the earlier shows.
The 80s cartoon, I'm guessing? Yeah.
The 2004 one.
Yeah, but I think it was probably 2004 that I watched.
It was 2003, actually.
Whatever, the point is...
I forget, what was she like in that show?
I don't know.
She was a scientist voiced by Ash Ketchum.
Veronica Taylor.
Okay, anywho, Pedro, you were saying about...
Well, that show was made by 4 kids, so it makes sense. Anyway, yeah, once again, like Nate said very well, you have got to be kidding. So yeah, more climbing. Don't look down.
Oh, well, Nate, you know what you have to do. I mean, you're following in the footsteps of one of your 4 founding fathers.
So yeah, people
Crash
who...
Bandicoot.
So yeah, people who are incredibly afraid of heights should not play this game because it might give them a bit of... Yeah.
I'm pretty sure they'll be fine.
This is a video.
Well, actually, Shiro, depends on how well.
Hey guys, could you imagine if this game was compatible with that PlayStation VR?
Basically, Shiro, there are certain following games. There are certain climbing parts where you're actually looking straight down into the possible abyss you can fall. So that can be a bit. Yeah.
Seriously, if this game were compatible with PlayStation VR,
someone with Fear of Heights plays the PlayStation VR version of this.
Yeah,
I can imagine if they were playing it with that they'd be traumatized.
Yeah.
See, even Nate's like, wasn't I just here? Alright. Okay, here we go.
Meta humor. I think.
Here we go. Basically, those
it's just a bunch of very narrow ledges, and if you very much lose your grip on, you could die.
Yeah, no biggie.
Yeah, it's a common thing that explorers like Nathan go through.
All right.
Boing, boing, boing.
Okay. Edge.
If when I get to doing Uncharted 2, and if I ever come to a section where there's just a lot of hopping and stuff, I'll just edit in some sound effects or something.
Boingy, 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 boingy.
Yeah, boing.
Oh, Dweebs, you're gonna love the train sequence.
The Sonic Spring sound
effect. Everybody loves the train sequence.
Is that from the second game?
Yeah, it's the most iconic moment from the second game.
I don't think I've got to that. I'm not quite sure I've got to that bit.
Basically, the first one not so much, because the first one is before they introduced the set pieces, but discounting the first one, pretty much every Uncharted game has that one big set piece that everybody remembers. Like, the second game is the train, the third game is the plane.
Uncharted 4 looks like it's actually going to try and do multiple big iconic ones as opposed to just one big memorable one.
Well, I'm guessing Neil and Bruce want to end with a bang. Literally, considering there's a lot of explosions in those set pieces.
and then it turns out that the set pieces are Nathan jumping from a train onto a plane.
I wouldn't be surprised. I wouldn't be surprised if they do that.
Yeah.
You know, it'd be funny. You know, it'd be funny is if they
CinemaSins would probably hate that game.
Well, actually, like I said, Webs, go check Dardigan on YouTube, because he's made Sins videos of all three games, and they're very good. Check them out.
You know what would be funny is if, like, well, they stick to their guns on technically ending Uncharted, you know, go with Nathan's story, but then they sort of continue it a la looking more into Nate's brother. And then we have a whole new set of games following Nate's brother, voiced by Troy Baker.
Which is funny, because apparently he wasn't supposed to be voiced by Troy Baker in the first place.
Really? What's the story behind that?
Basically, they cast an actor while Amy Hennig was still at the company, but she left, and so Druckmann and Straley took over. So they had to, Druckmann had to rewrite a lot of the stuff along with his writing team. So, and that also involved some voice actor recasts. So the guy who was originally supposed to voice Nate's brother, who ended up being a voice in the game's trailers, left the project, and so they got Troy Baker, because, you know, we have to have a...
Because you're Troy Baker.
Because, yeah, this is like Troy Baker's 8,000th game this year or something.
Yeah.
Let's see. And assuming that all of a sudden...
Well, the thing is... Well,
Attorney 6, and Troy I'm Baker always, will also be an ace Attorney 6.
I'm going to be honest. I always get really antsy and a little bit nervous when they do rewrites and recastings and stuff.
Well,
that's kind of the case of practically every movie, including one of your favorites, Mission Impossible. Well, then again, Mission Impossible is literally writing on the fly.
When it's as widely publicized, and especially considering that there's a bit of an exodus of people from Naughty Dog at some point...
Again, for me it's better when it's publicized, because, well, that's at least the studio being open about it. You don't want them always being so silent about it.
Honestly, there's the thing, Neil Druckmann has been writing this for this series since the first game anyway, so he knows this shit when it comes to this series, so I wouldn't be worried, honestly.
And honestly, Dibs, think about it. Would you rather they stuck with the same script but have practically no one who was, you know, involved in making that original script trying to bring that to life? I mean, it can occasionally work, but, well, in some cases, you kind of get stuff like AI.
Never mind. I'll bring that up later. All right. Here we go.
So, yeah, might as well look up games that Troy Baker will be in this year.
And, but don't you see...
Jover, I think at this point it'd be much more simpler to look at games he's not in this year.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm talking about this year, though.
You see, Dwebs, the thing is, this is how it works, basically. If you want to be a proper, successful AAA franchise, you have to have Troy Baker at least in one of your games. That's pretty much the rule right now. MGS5 just managed to get him right at the very last one, right before Kojima left.
And so did Bioshock Infinite.
Bioshock Infinite got him. What else?
How is he's even an Ace Attorney.
And
he's in Layton, he's in Pokemon.
He was in Pokemon?
Yeah, he was.
When was that?
Apparently at some point he also voiced a Jigglypuff, though that wasn't for Smash Bros.
What?
I can't quite picture him voicing Jigglypuff.
Oh my god.
Think about it, Pedro. They alter the voice heavily.
Okay. I'm pretty sure they just got Rachel Lillis, who did her in the old anime or something.
Yeah, that too.
Hey, Shira, is still there?
Yep.
Okay, we're about to get a really funny cutscene in a moment.
He has been in a Smash game, voiced for it.
Oh, shit. It's Elena's bag.
Uh-oh. Oh, crap.
Oh. Well, she's dead.
That's okay. There are sequels, so we know she doesn't die.
Yeah, help.
I know, I'm joking.
unless Nathan Drake somehow managed to reincarnate her as a zombie and married her.
Here you go. I love this cutscene.
Ow.
Elena, what the hell's she doing?
Hello?
Buka, Pintu!
Hold on.
Intruder.
I guess it didn't work.
Nate, when you're bragging, turn off the microphone.
No,
shit.
Note to self. Never brag about being successful at something because immediately they will not be successful.
Especially when the microphone is on.
Wow. Hey, guys, would you... Oh, never mind.
Go ahead.
Yeah, that kind of is a recipe for disaster. Is there something you want to say about the game? I was just about to bring up some more Troy Baker trivia. If you have something more relevant to say, go ahead.
I'm done with the whole, chastising Nathan for doing stuff on the mic was on.
Go ahead.
Okay. Well, in that case, would you guys believe that Troy Baker's real start in video game casting was actually Blood Rain 2?
Oh, really?
We have Blood Rain 2 to thank for Troy Baker making his entry into the video game cast.
Which is funny because the first Blood Rain game was the reason that we're having Laura Bailey in a lot of games.
Yeah.
Wow.
They were together from the beginning.
Not quite the beginning.
Sort of, but not really.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's
Destiny. Well, one big difference, Shiroi, is that they started in Blood Rain games, but like each of them have completely different games. Like when it comes to their breakout performance that made them go popular. Like with Laura Bailey, it was her role as Rey in Persona 4. With Troy Baker, it was unfortunately his role as Snow in Final Fantasy 13.
Well, if it's any consolation, Pedro, it was a combination of that, but also his role in Transformers War for Cybertron, which also came out the same year.
I guess, sure.
Where he played Jetfire, Zeta Prime, and others.
It's just that Final Fantasy XIII was the first big-name AAA franchise he'd ever been in.
Huh. Yeah, it's a shame, because he's been in a lot of good games like Tales of Vesperia.
Now, Tales of Vesperia is not exactly a AAA game because those games have very low budgets by our.
Go ahead, Pedro.
Yes.
The character Laura Bailey played in Persona 4 is called Rise.
That's it. Sorry, I was going through the Japanese name. Anyway.
And then the next big game that got Troy Baker noticed was, believe it or not, a Sonic game. Oh, Sonic Colors.
Wait, yeah. What about Sonic Colors?
Basically, Shiroi, Sonic Colors got Troy Baker even more noticed because, as you know, Sonic has a huge fan base, regardless of games. Troy Baker is nowadays the voice of Espio.
Actually, apparently, in the Rio game, he's not Espio's voice anymore. They got discount Troy Baker in again.
Matthew Mercer?
Rio.
Apparently, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Basically, Shiroi, Alphonse Dawson was Alphonse Dawson was voicing Esper at some point, but now he's being voiced by Harry.
Yeah. Well, there's a lot of meta stuff we can apply to these games, isn't there?
Yeah.
So after Sonic Colors, then the next
Meta-human.
Mark was, of course.
While there's still bits of Bingy left, speaking of Uncharted 4, do you guys remember the controversy regarding Laura Bailey's casting?
Yeah. What's wrong with that?
Basically, when it was announced, people got pissed that she was playing a South African character.
You mean the new female character that got introduced during the Game Awards show?
Who cares? Seriously.
But Pedro, in video games, people should only play their own races.
That's the thing, you know, people are trying to saying those kind of things are trying to say that they're trying to avoid racism. The very fact that you're doing that means you're racist.
Heck. For example, Edgeworth in the classic trilogy is actually voiced by a black guy.
Yeah, if anything, the fact that you were the one who noticed that makes you the racist one.
Yeah, and you don't see me complaining about that. Heck, I'm black and I voice Phoenix, an Asian American.
Like I said,
the people who say these things sound like the people on Tumblr who are like, you're not allowed to write about, gay characters in fanfiction unless you're gay yourself.
It's like I say about the whole James Bond thing when Daniel Craig eventually gets recast. I don't have a problem with them casting a different kind of race actor as Bond as long as this is another reboot.
It's a new character all in general.
If you try and turn Bond black during the Daniel Craig continuity where he's clearly white, then I would go, no, you're just being fucking stupid.
Or if you could just pull a
speaking of fucking stupid, okay, there are obvious reasons why as to this shouldn't happen. But somebody said, well, like, why can't Bond be a woman? And I'm like, he's not the Doctor. There is no possibility of him ever being a woman.
Yeah, because Ian Fleming clearly wrote him as a guy.
Not to mention...
He's called James Bond, not Janine Bond.
That sort of imagination is nice and stuff.
The Doctor could eventually be a woman.
Yeah,
Look
at the Master.
James Bond is like, the character is male.
Yeah. It's like...
Try to convince Anita of that.
Although, apparently... Okay, I should mention... Apparently, in one of the Bond books by Ian Fleming, he did describe Bond as a white guy, so that could open up yet another can of worms.
Yeah. You want to know the sad thing, Pedro?
Wasn't it Fanfalstick where they shoved in, like,
a character?
The big problem with that movie wasn't so much the casting. It wouldn't really be a problem considering it was supposed to be a reboot of the franchise anyway.
Besides, it's Michael B. Jordan. He's an awesome
actor. I love Michael B. Jordan. The problem is that, he could have made a really good Johnny Storm. The problem is that he was cast in an incredibly horrible written role.
And not only that, but part of the reason people were also complaining, well, granted, the more sensible people, mind you, not the ones who just yell because he's black, but also, it did seem a bit off-putting that Johnny Storm and Sue Storm aren't even biological twins. In fact, they had to go out of their way to make Sue Storm an adopted sister, which makes me wonder, hey, you know, she's smart and stuff, why can't she be black as well? And yes, I have pointed out the controversy that Johnny Storm is in fact portrayed as a dropout loser black kid. You know, it's not like you could have cast him as like Mr. Fantastic, who's smart or something.
Yeah, if that were true, and considering Trank also co-wrote the script as well as directed the movie, that could kind of make him a bit of a racist.
Well, honestly, at this point, I wouldn't be surprised if Trank has that hidden under the hood, despite him apparently being on good terms with Michael B. Jordan. Because Josh Trank is the kind of guy who, before Fanforstic, we barely really heard of him. He did a success or two, but, you know, he wasn't really the talk of town. But this whole incident has revealed way too much information.
Okay, anyway, trying to go back to topic. I had to raise the water level by opening up those two channels so I could raise to these stairs.
Ladies and gentlemen, Nathan Drake is the sole cause of
Chapter
Blood
6,
Warning. Unlock- the water's rising, it's his fault.
Chapter 6, Unlocking the Past.
Nathan Drake is a freaking monster.
To think, we somehow went from talking about Troy Baker to fanforstic and racism. Basically, but yeah, Troy Baker will be in at least 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, about 6 games this year so far by my count.
Jesus Christ. Who's to... Well, I wonder how many games I pre-ordered he'll be in aside from Uncharted 4.
Let's see, Ace Attorney 6, Final Fantasy 15, oh yeah, and of course Uncharted 4.
Well, actually, to be fair, we still don't have any confirmation if he's going to be in that game or not.
Which one?
Final Fantasy 15. So far, the only voice actors we have confirmed is for Kingsglaive. We have Lena Hadley as Luna, Sean Bean as King Regis, obviously,
Aaron Paul.
But aside from that, no, we have no confirmation about any other voice actors. I mean, we've heard them in the demo, but as far as we can, but there's no credits
of
any kind.
That's right. There's
no credits of any sort in the demo, so we don't even know. And for all we know, that the voices in the demo are not even the final voices anyway, so.
A wonderful top 2015 where he was in 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 games that year.
He gets about.
Yeah, he does.
And would you believe that in the same year he voiced Superman, Arkham Knight, and Two-Face, and Batman in LEGO Dimensions?
Yeah, because, you know, the role of Batman keeps switching every game.
Does it? I thought it was kept consistent for at least the LEGO games where he voices Batman.
Seriously, I mean, it depends on what continuity. It can either be Kevin Conroy, or it could be Troy Baker, or it could be this guy or that guy.
Yeah. Well, hey, if there's one thing we have Troy Baker good for, he could actually do a pretty good Mark Hamill impression.
We're actually getting the real Mark Hamill for that Killing Joke adaptation, so...
What? Remember, Dribs, Arkham City was supposed to be Hamill's retirement from the Joker.
Well, then again, how many times have people, quote-unquote, retired from stuff only to come back?
Yeah. Well, Hamill was actually doing a good job of kicking it serious, hence why they had to bring in Troy Baker for Arkham Origins. And then, well, I won't spoil when he started coming back, because that technically is a spoiler... But let's just say at some point Hamill started coming back again.
Should we just say Killing? Should we just say the Killing Joke adaptation?
Well, there was a lot more before the Killing Joke adaptation. I'll just give people this in 2015.
All right, everybody. In the next part, we'll finally reach Elena and see exactly what the hell she's up to.
Considering all the possibilities, I even want to think about what she might have been up to.
She's just
clean happy thoughts, Dwibs. Clean happy thoughts.
Ladies and gentlemen, Dwibs is a pervert.
See you next part, everybody.
Yeah, see ya.
See ya.